So, thank you very much. So first, I need to thank all the speakers for this session with topics after my own heart, exactly my own heart, because this is a blend of computer graphics and mathematics. I was very happy to have both in the same conference. It was just a conference perfect for me. Thank you very much for your presentations. I want also to thank Sylvain for inviting me. And also, I must confess that it's extremely stressful for me because you guys keep the bar very high, and I am as stressed as Jeremy, who is defending his PhD thesis tomorrow morning. Okay, so I will continue my talk. I hope I won't be sued by Disney for this. I hope I won't be sued by Voronoy as well, because I misspelled his name. Okay. So what I will be talking about is different topics related to Voronoy diagrams. So it's old stuff and new stuff that I wanted to put on a new perspective, the perspective of fabrication, but more generally perspective of connections that is appearing more and more, connection between computer science, mathematics, and physics. I think they are very interesting things that are likely to occur at this interface. And maybe some of these things could use Voronoi diagrams. I'm unsure of that, but I want to talk about that. So first, my motivations. Well, there is these works done by Sylvain and his co-workers. As a matter of fact, the book, this Greg Ward's book. this is an old style, I didn't do that. this is an old slide, I didn't do that for this occasion. It has been there for a while, but this is my belief that maybe we could use these Voronoi diagrams for optimizing structures and fabricating them, as Sylvain and his co-workers already showed. Another motivation is the design. Designing, they got very beautiful shapes. I'm amazed by these shapes. I like them. It looks like biology. It looks like I think they are really extraordinary, these shapes. Or you can think about this swimming pool in Pekin. From inside, it's even more amazing. And last but not least, my true motivation is wonder. I think these shapes are really beautiful, as I said, but I think there is more hidden beauty in there, even more hidden beauty in the math and in the symmetry. I think symmetry is a very important keyword, and this is something I'd like to understand, how symmetry plays a role, interplays with minimizing something, minimizing under symmetry constraints. Very wonderful things occur. I'll try to explain that, to share it with you. It will be difficult, but I will try. And so this picture is a very old picture by René Descartes. Hein, you know, je pense, donc je suis, in English, I don't know how to say that. I'm thinking, therefore I am, something like that. He was a philosopher, but also a mathematician. At that time, they were thinking about gravity. They didn't have Newton yet, with forces that act in the distance. And they thought that gravity was transferred by a medium called the ether, as some vortices in the ether, and that could interact along Voronoi cells. There were already some Voronoi cells to model the universe. Here, S is for Sun, and there are many planets over there. And you will see that it was not very far away from some ways of modeling astrophysics and the Big Bang and phenomena like that. Okay, so my first topic will be an algorithm. It's really an old topic for those who know me, but this is really a starting point. I wanted to put that into perspective, central Voronoi tessellation. So first, Voronoi diagram, what is it? You got a set of points, xi. I denote x will be a point in the 2D space. And Voronoi diagram is a partition of regions that are nearer to one point than to the other. And since an image is worth a thousand words, an animation is worth even more. You can think about it like that. This is the way I'm seeing a Voronoi diagram. this looks like biology or colonies of bacteria. This is a possible way of seeing it. But you can also see it from a more mathematical point of view as the minimization diagram of a set of functions. You have got a set of distance functions to each the point. It's in fact, it has one more dimension. And if you look at it from above, you will see the Voronoy diagram. Both points of view are interesting even when you manipulate the formula. So now, what is a centroidal Voronoi tessellation? This is simply the idea of a simple algorithm. Here I've got a random Voronoi diagram, and then I will display the centroids here. Here the centroids in green. And what I'm going to do is to move the points, the black dots, over the centroids again and again. When you do that, it becomes more and more regular. So this is an algorithm called Lévy relaxation. And if you do that again and again, then something that I like is when you play with it, you can add points. It looks like a diffusion process. It looks like the heat equation. And in fact, there are more similarities with the heat equation. If you look at the equation, it's very similar to the heat equation. Something else that strikes me is that it's smooth. The evolution is smooth, and so I thought there were some regularity in the process. So this is why I wanted to study this process. So the classical algorithm, it's well known that it can be thought of as a gradient descent. Gradient descent, so it minimizes an objective function by following the gradient. So what is the objective function? It is this function, which is basically the sum of the inertia momenta of all the Voronoi cells. Minimize that. And then you want to compute the gradient. It's not very easy to compute the gradient. It's defined over a Voronoi diagram. And the combinatorics of this Voronoi diagram, it changes the equation in terms. It's piecewise defined in a huge space of configuration, which are all the coordinates of all the points. But if you write it at the minimization diagram, then in fact what you minimize is the lower envelope of a family of quadratic functions. And there is a very nice theorem, which is called the envelope theorem, or in convex analysis it's called the subgradient theorem, that says that the gradient of the dashed curve here is equal to the gradient of the quadratic function that is the lowest here. And so this makes computations much simpler. And if you do them, you end up with this formula for the gradients. They were known for a long time, but after 3 or 4 pages of derivation. But using that, you can do that in 2 lines. And so this is the gradient with respect to one point. So what is MI? This is the volume of the Voronoi cell. And GI is the centroid of the Voronoi cell. Then it tells a little bit why Voronoi relaxation works. It works because if the XI and the GI coincide, then the gradient is zero. And then we reach a stationary point of this energy. Something that it doesn't tell is why doing exactly the Lloyd step minimizes the energy. We need to study that a little bit more. It's in the paper by Xiang Du. He proves that this always decreases this objective function doing so. So this is something interesting. We studied the function. We could prove that it was smooth C2 almost everywhere, except from some configurations that are very special. And we designed a more efficient algorithm. If it's C2, we can use higher order methods to minimize it. To prove that it's C2, how it works, you need to study what happens when there is a change of combinatorics. And so there is this singular configuration. And then by doing the Taylor expansion of the expansions, you prove that all the higher order terms cancel out, and that you get C2 continuity. So after that, you can put that in a computer, develop an efficient numerical schemes for surfaces, for volumes in 2D, 3D, 4D. If you do that, it looks like that, so you can put more points. And in the end, we got a very efficient algorithm that can be used to compute this centroidal Voronoi tessellation for surfaces and volumes. The implementation is available if you need to use it. It's in our softwares, Geogram and Graphite. So now something we wanted to do was playing with, now we got an objective function. We can change it a little bit to see what we can do with it. Something I wanted to do was blowing square bubbles. So I will tell you what I mean by changing, replacing the L2 norm here by the LP norm. We could expect to pack shapes that would be like squares. This is exactly the same trick as Rudiger Westermann presented before. Instead of doing L infinity, which is problematic, in fact we can, but this requires splitting the domain into the cells along the diagonal lines. Well, it's easier to do LP, and then you can compute derivatives. I will tell you what it gives. Imagine you want to obtain a regular grid of Voronoi cell. So this Voronoi diagram is a centroidal Voronoi tessellation because all the black dots on the centroids of the Voronoi cells coincide. And therefore, if I optimize it, nothing happens, nothing moves, all the gradients are zero. But if I tickle it a little bit like that, like that, okay, you see that it was not a stable minimum. So it moves, it's a saddle point in fact. So we cannot expect the algorithm to converge to patterns like that. But if we change the norm, so here it's L4, not really sufficient, so I take L8. So for Rudiger it was L16, infinity was 16, for us it's 8. And then if I tickle it, check, it goes back to my regular set of squares. So I've got an algorithm, even more interesting. I start from that, change the norm, and it will drag it to a regular grid. It's interesting. Why I wanted to develop that, it was for generating a certain class of meshes, hexahedral meshes, that are very good for some numerical simulations. It was 2010. But in fact, this is clearly not the best way of doing that. But after that, Nicolas Rey from my team, Dmitry Sokolov, they have other ideas. It's a much better idea to compute a global parameterization to do that. It works much, much better. But this is another story, and I'm not going to talk about that. I will continue to talk about Voronoi diagrams. So Voronoi diagrams, now I will switch to the other part of the presentation. They got very nice connections with some discretizations of physics that stem from the least action principle. So before going back to the Voronoi diagram, I will talk a little bit about physics. So before that, I introduce Yann Brunier, who is another professor in Polytechnic School. He got very strong mathematicians in this school, and who is responsible for a big part of all this activity around optimal transport in France. It inspired many researchers in this field, and in particular his connections with physics. So the least action principle, I've got a couple of slides about that, because I think this is something very beautiful. There is a big sense of aesthetic around it, and the way some formulas emerge from it. So it's a mathematical theory of physics. And from this mathematical theory of physics, you can deduce theorems, and we got well-known results that appear as theorems from this least action principles, like Newton's law. You can retrieve Newton's law as theorems, but then you need axioms. So the axiom from which you start is that there exists a function that depends on x. X will be the positions of all the particles of the system. X dot will be the speeds of all the partitions of the system, and t time. And that describes, in a certain sense, I will elaborate on that, the state of a physical system. Describes in which sense? In the sense that the at position speed time, okay? That in the sense that the belief is that nature, the tries to minimize the following function. That the motion of the system will emerge as the minimization of the integral of this function. So these are nearly the only two axioms, but there are some subtleties. Something very natural and that everybody knows, electricity takes the shortest path. The laws of optics, you can derive them by saying that the light took the shortest time to do its path, taking into account the variation of the speed. And this is N1 sine sinus I1 equals N2 sinus I2, Frenet's law. You can derive it from this principle. Here it's for general, it's for a dynamic system. So the first thing you can do with it, you can derive this equation by writing that this integral is minimized, studying the small variation if you perturb the path a little bit, and doing bipartite integration. You end up with this equation. We learn a little bit in the system. But now we need to add a little bit of knowledge to be able to learn more, to derive some physical law. And this knowledge will be that the law of physics are invariants with respect to certain symmetries. Here, for instance, if you take invariance with respect to a Galileo change of frame, then you can derive different things from the invariance with respect to time. You can prove that this quantity is constant during the motion of the frame. It is preserved. And this quantity, we got a simple name for it. This is what we call energy. And so this is I was very amazed to learn that, because energy, I thought it was like an atomic notion. Here, no, it's not an atomic notion, it's a theorem. It's a mathematical notion that emerges from a minimization principle with respect to symmetries. And then energy emerges. And from the fact that if you do the same experiment here and 100 kilometers away, but under the same circumstances, we obtain the same results, invariance by translation, and then the momentum is preserved. This is the same kind of reasoning. And finally, by the isotropy of space, if I rotate everything, I will obtain the same, and then you got preservation of angular momentum. This is a very general theorem by Amy Noether that whenever a system minimizes a Lagrangian with respect to some symmetries, then a certain number of quantities are preserved. And so this gives mathematical meaning of energy, momentum, and angular momentum. So before going further, and so then you can rederive for a free particle the first law of Newton. You can the expression of the Lagrangian is not given to you. It plays a second high game, and then can deduce, okay, so it looks like that, there are some symmetries, so it can only depend on the norm of the speed vector. There should be a constant, a quadratic form, if I take it as a scalar. Another physical notion that appears, it's a mass, and so on and so forth. So the only possible expression of the Lagrangian for a free particle is this one. Constant is the mass, and we obtain this one. We retrieve the kinetic energy. And for a particle in a field, then you can retrieve the second law of Newton for forces equals m times acceleration. So I've got two more slides for physics, and then I will get back to other things. So, if you go to the relativistic setting, you just replace the Galilean change of coordinates with the Lorentz change of coordinates, where there is a compression of time depending on the speed. Lorentz discovered that. Poincaré studied what could be deduced from that, and Einstein did put the last missing step in there and explained that to everybody. But then if you write the equation of the Lagrangian, you deduce the expression of the energy, find this expression of the energy, and when the particle doesn't move, there is E0 equals mc squared. It appears at steel. And quantum physics can be also deduced from that. Schrödinger equation, it can be deduced by minimizing a Lagrangian, and it was the PhD thesis of Richard Feynman, who obtained the Nobel Prize of Physics for this. Something very, very astonishing, very esoteric. Feynman's passing to already Schrödinger's equation is already esoteric because nobody knows what the components of these complex numbers mean. But here it's even more esoteric because there is an integral over all possible passes that can go back in time. But it's wonderful that the same variational principle can lead to all these aspects of physics. So now we'll talk a little bit of fluids. So in fluid, and you got the Lagrange point of view, you got many, many particles that move. Some of forces equals m times acceleration. We can imagine that easily, and they interact and collect each other. But it's difficult to keep track of all these particles. If you are under a bridge, it's easier to imagine that you watch at the flow from the top of the bridge. You decompose water by in a regular grid. You can think about a grid that rests on the sides of the river, and you look at the particles that go through the squares and in there, and you look at the field of speeds, but these field of speeds are not attached to the particles, they are attached to the grid points. In fact, this will be the speed of the particle that passes through the grid point at some time. Doing that, but you can do different things. You can relate the derivative of this speed to the derivative of the speed particles. Doing this is called material derivative, and then doing that, you can rewrite the sum of forces equals m times acceleration. Then introduce some constraint, preservation of mass. So this is how you derive the equation of the fluid. So you can also say that they minimize this action, something, and in the end you obtain the Euler equation and the constraint that the fluid can be compressed. So now what is the link with Voronoy diagrams? And we are quite far away from Voronoy diagrams, but I will go back to them and to tell you it's also related to mass transport that Marie-Paul Kenny was using right before for painting this landscape with trees. And fluids, so there is a nice relation by Benamou and Brognier about imagine you got a fluid or a gas that has a certain distribution of the densities at times t1, and another distribution of densities at time t2. And you are considering this following problem. You want to minimize the kinetic energy of the gas during the motion. You have limit conditions that this is this corresponds to T1 and to T2, and also the continuity equation. But here, I'm not at all constraining the speeds at time T1 and T2. Therefore, the motion is very simple. All the particles go in straight lines at constant speed. So it's not very interesting. Yeah? But in fact, what we don't know is which particle goes where. It's a coupling problem. It becomes a coupling problem. And it's equivalent to another problem, which is this problem. You try to find the function that goes from here to here, that minimizes the integration of the square distance times the density, such that T preserves measure. So what it means, it means that if I take any blob from my two space, I look at its free image, and it contains some quantity of matter here and here, whatever the blob should be. It's a horrible constraint. If you want to find T, how can I do a program that will find T for all possible Bs? And this is truly horrible. But then there are things that happen. There is wonder, mathematical wonder, to solve the problem. So the mathematical wonder to solve the problem is Kantorovich. So Kantorovich, what he did? First, he said, we are going to search in a larger space that is simpler. So I can draw it in 1D. I can't do more than 1D, because in 1D becomes 2D, in 2D it will be 4D. So I do it in 1D. Suppose you want to transport this segment to that segment. What you do, you work in the product space of the two lines here, this square. And what you are looking at is the graph of T. The graph of T is this diagonal segment. It tells you that this point goes here, this point goes here, and so on and so forth. So the unknown is a measure, probability measure, supported by the product space of the two elements. And then you got constraints saying that if you project your measure onto the form space, you retrieve the initial density. If you project it onto the two space, you retrieve the final density. And so, and you want to minimize this function. But then it's extremely simple because the constraints, they are linear, and the objective function is linear as well. So what you can do duality. This Kantorovich did it, and even more, he invented it. And then, if you do the dual, there is a Lagrange multiplier. In addition, it can be restricted to a more regular space of C convex functions, but I won't elaborate on that. But then you just need to find a single Lagrange multiplier psi. In the end, if you replace everything, you can see that t, so the function that says where to go, actually, what you are looking for, will be the gradient of this Lagrange multiplier, plus a term here. So this also links it with a well-known non-linear equation, which is the Monge-Ampère equation. If you can search directly for this Lagrange multiplier, and so H is the Hessian, so it's an equation that controls the Hessian function. It's a highly non-linear equation, very non-linear, but it can be thought of as a non-linear generalization of the Laplace or Poisson equation that is well known. So this is interesting. We got links between optimal transport, this equation by Bruno. And links with physics. So if you can solve this equation, we got new ways of doing physics and minimizing action. And so what is wonderful is the constraint was horrible. Remember all the beasts. But here actually we got a very simple concave maximization problem to solve. And there is a unique maximum here. This is I was really amazed to see that, seeing the initial problem and finally the solution. So now, if you are a programmer like me, say, okay, it's cool, but how can I program that in a computer? There are several ways, and one possible way, considering a special case, where your form space, it has a density, the function is very regular, so density. The two space is a probability measure, it will be a sum of direct masses. So it's not symmetrical. And then if you write the function that is optimized, so our unknown is just a set of values, psi, attached to each blue dot. We are just looking for this set of values. This is Lagrange multiplier, it's a vector of discrete values. Good news for a computer, we can program it. And if you write the equation, you replace everything, so I draw everything in the same place here. Here I still play the equation, there was a Legendre transform here. I write it as the inf. You remember Voronoy diagram as the minimization diagram of a family of functions. Here you start to see my point. There is the inf here, so I can reorder the terms, and this will decompose the domain into a set of cells. And these cells, they correspond to all the mass that will be sucked by each of this well in a certain sense. So, but this is slightly different from a Voronoi diagram. This is something called the Laguerre diagram. Mathematicians, they call it the Laguerre diagram. Computer scientists, they call it the power diagram, which is the special case where this is the square distance here. Laguerre diagram can be more general than that. So what it is, an idea visually. So I still take my my Voronoy diagram, the minimization diagram of the distance function. I replace distance with square distance, since square is monotonous, I'm not changing the diagram. So why I'm doing that? Because right after that, I shift the point like that. And if I do that, the intersection between all these parabolas, these paraboloids, are parabolas, but they are in a plane that is orthogonal to the screen. They remain orthogonal to the screen if I look at it from above. And so these parabolas, they just appear as straight lines. So then by shifting these parabolas, I've got tuning buttons that allow me to change the areas of these Voronoi cells. And this is actually what transport tries to compute. It will try to find the right tuning of these heights in such a way that each cell will suck the exact amount of matter it was supposed to suck. So the theory of transport is very general. It works with probability measures. So you don't need to discretize it because it already encompasses this semi-discrete setting. And so you just obtain that that there is a single maximum of the function and that it will do the job. Something interesting that I observed is that this objective function is related to centroidal Voronoi diagrams, the objective function of centroidal diagrams, through a change of variable. You just add one coordinates to the points and you compute centroidal Voronoi diagrams. So with respect to the additional coordinates, the concave function, with respect to the first coordinates, it's not as well behaved and it has many local minima, but then it's something interesting because we can move the points and we can tune the areas of the Voronoi cells with one single function that is smooth. This is what I like, that it is smooth. So what it means intuitively, means suppose I want to transport this Voronoi diagram to the right. So I draw it on a transparent sheet of paper, and then I start lifting the points. If I lift the points, you can see a little bit, and it's difficult to see, that the shadow is moving towards the right. So more formally, let's do some experiments to see what happens. If I draw my Voronoi diagram on a plane and tilt the plane, for doing a translation, it will not work because it will spread it over by a factor of 1 over cosine alpha. So it's not what should be done for a translation. For a translation, you need to curve the sheet of paper a little bit, using a square root equation. Then doing that, convergent beams will exactly counterbalance the 1 over cos alpha factor. In equation, it gives that the height should be equals to this one. So there is minus the minimum of all the translation vector dot the piece in order to avoid taking the square root of a negative number. But you can put any positive number here, it will not change the result. It's invariant by translation. And then if you want to transform a disk into two disks, what you will do, you will put two square root wings like that on top of the disk, and it will send the two halves to the two disks here. So let's see if it really behaves like that by doing a computer experiment. So here I've got my disk. I did program the optimization of this function, and then you see that it got this motion that is quite natural. I think it looks like physics because of it minimizes this kinetic energy. Now, if you look at the potential, so I'm plotting this function. This function is nearly the potential, not exactly, because there is a factor. But if you want to know where a point goes, you lift it onto the function and move through the normal vector to the graph of this function. And when you intersect R2 again, it tells you where the point lands. And actually, what we do is solving a PDE, a non-linear PDE, and the solution is the graph of this function. This PDE is the Monge-Ampère equation. you can see the solutions of this PDE are very irregular. There is a break here of C1 continuity, C0 continuity, whenever some points go to one side and to the other side. And here, there is a singularity locus that has interesting properties, that is actively studied in the mathematical community, but it's very, very hard. There's a few results in 2D, but no results in 3D. So maybe visualizing it will help the mathematicians to find something. we've got some example before concluding. No, it's not the right one. Okay, it's here. So two spheres that morph to one sphere, and it's computed in 3D. And there are some tetrahedra inside. And you see that the tetrahedra become anisotropic as emerge. They can become very anisotropic. So we need to have robust geometry to compute the Voronoi diagram, which we had. We worked very hard in having a robust Voronoi diagram and intersection code. Take some other examples that I have. Oh yes, there was the armadillo in Paolo's presentation, and we have an armadillo too. This is the new bunny, the armadillo. So I'm loading it. It's quite a big model. So it has several million points, and here I am morphing it to a sphere. I like it very very much. It looks like a hedgehog. Look at that. It is computed in 3D. I can show you inside the volumetric mesh. There is quite a large number of tetrahedra. With the previous algorithm, it was impossible to compute such a large scale optimal transport. Going back to there, still got a couple of examples. Oh yes, this one. This is not a very serious example that I have, but the idea is that you get this Hoberman stuff. It looks like a small sphere, and if you throw them, they expand into larger structures. It's very funny because it can be tiny and become larger. And the larger they are, the larger expansion factor they got. And so there is all this trend for printing materials that are called oxalic. You by having tiny rods or structure, you control the way they can expand. And if you could control the way they expand in such a way that they preserve the Jacobian, then we could imagine foldable structure like this one that we could compress to say a sphere. So I've got this one. So if you didn't see it, colors are weird, I don't know why, but same thing as I did. Okay, and here we could compute it for this object. This is very irregular geometry. We are happy that the code did not crash on that and remain stable. And then if you compute the optimal transport to the sphere, the volume is preserved during the transform. And then you get this sphere. The mesh becomes very anisotropic, but the computation is still stable. And this is all done in volume, and there are some tetrahedra here that are anisotropic. We experimented different settings, variable density. Can take into account the variable density over the domain. There are some related works by Schwarzburg and co-workers at SIGGRAPH. As I said, you control this surface, and the solution of the Monge-Ampère equation is the graph of the function, the two wings that I was showing. How much time do I have, Sigra? That will be fine. I am reaching the end. And by solving the Monge-Ampère equation, you can find the shape of a lens that will produce some images by making the rays of light converge. This is nearly the same equation as the equation I have shown. So this is something interesting. The and you absolutely not recognize the image that is projected here. It's more, looks like more a Voronoy diagram. It's really interesting to take. I encourage you to watch the video of this paper. It's interesting. Something else you can think of is caustics. You've got the surface of a swimming pool, and the way the beams of light converge, it creates these structures in the bottom of the swimming pool. And these are structures that we can observe in a completely different setting also, which is a large-scale structure of the universe. There were some simulations done in the Max Planck Institute for astrophysics. So I've got the video here. So you see there is quite a large number of particles. Large scale, 1 gigaparsec. Parsec is around 2 light years, so it's really huge structures. And the particles, they don't represent stars, they don't even represent galaxies, they represent clusters of galaxies. And if you look at it, remember my swimming pool, it really looks like the caustics in the swimming pool. But there is a reason for that, because there is a way of modeling the motion of all these stars, where their movement is governed by the gradient of a convex potential. This is exactly the same thing as I was drawing with my two wings that will deform to concentrate the light of beams. But here, it moves the stars and makes them converge in a certain position. So it's a 4D surface of a 3D pool, but it does the same thing. And so doing this, you can do the inverse problem. Take the current distribution of stars and try to inverse it, as what was done by Uriel Frisch and co-workers, and also Yann Grenier in the years 2000. But in the years 2000, they were using a combinatorial algorithm that was in O of n cube or O of n squared log n. It was taking a quite big amount of time for a few thousand particles. And with semi-discrete algorithm, we can go much, much faster, and we applied it to 1 million particles. And this year, Quentin Mérigo invented the Dart-Newton algorithm, so that we implemented in 3D. And so now we can do 1 million Dirac masses in a few minutes, and 10 million Dirac masses in 1 year, 1 hour and a half. So it makes it scalable. So other topics that we are studying is more complicated equation, the Euler equation in a more complicated, more interesting setting. There are some neural schemes still studied by Quentin Mérigo that can do it, and also making the solver even faster. I think we can still gain some speed. So all the resources are online, source code is online. If you compute Voronoi diagrams and their intersection with meshes, we get very robust functions to do that. People interesting, I can do little demos after the presentation. And so we are starting a new project also with Erika Schwint, I think. Yes, she's there in the back of the auditorium. And so I want to thank you again for coming, and thank you for attention.